This is the Karoo, the original habitat of the quagga, the last of which was shot out by hunters over 100 years ago. In an attempt to bring back the quagga, or at least an animal that in appearance resembles the quagga, a selective breeding program has been underway for several years and is now starting to show signs of success. Earlier this year, SA National Parks lent their support to the project by making their Karoo parks available to the selected animals to continue breeding in their original habitat.
The most significant issue in the quagga breeding project is the acceptance that the quagga was the same species as the existing plains or Burchell zebra, which in effect means that the quagga didn't really become extinct. The only quagga to have been photographed alive was this mare, which died in the London Zoo in 1872. It clearly shows the characteristic stripes only on the forequarters, with unstriped legs and brownish rear quarters.
And the quagga being a zebra.
It was taxidermist Reinhold Rau who first suspected that the quagga simply adapted in colour to the Karoo landscape. Other scientists agreed that it was genetically virtually the same as existing plain zebras. He believes that to bring back the quagga, simply select plain zebras with coloration closest to that of the original quagga and selectively breed them until quaggas start reappearing. And this is exactly what he and the Quagga Project Committee has undertaken to do. With his conviction and determination, the project, which started in 1986, is well underway. Tracy, with her clear rump, is one of his best products so far, and Eric is almost ready to breed in his chosen habitat in the Karoo. This is the South African Museum in Cape Town, where Reinhold Rau has worked as a taxidermist for over 40 years. And it was here that he came across a poorly stuffed quagga foal. In the process of remounting the animal, he found tissue containing genetic material, flesh and blood, which provided the first clues to the genetic similarity with the plains zebra.
When was your curiosity stimulated into saying, is it a subspecies? What motivated you to do this research?
I knew all along that in the English literature, the quagga was usually mentioned as a separate species, while in the German language literature, the quagga was usually included as one of the plains zebras. In other words, I knew that there was this disagreement between the world scientists. Was it or was it not a separate species? And when I dismantled it and I found that the taxidermist here just filled up that skin as he received it from the Karoo with lots of bits of flesh still attached to it. And all this material, which if a taxidermist works with a fresh skin, that goes into the waste bin, that is offal, it's waste. But it came from an extinct animal, and therefore I wouldn't throw it away. It might just be that one day this material can in fact be useful to answer that question, was the quagga a species of its own or was it not?
Were other people asking that question at the time, or was it just you?
No, scientists accepted it. The quagga is extinct since 1883, when the very last animal died in the zoo in Amsterdam, and they were quite happy to accept that. And everybody thought we will never be able to answer this. And then it was a big surprise when eventually, in the early 1980s, this geneticist in California, Russell Higuchi, to everybody's surprise, extracted fragments of the quagga's DNA out of that tissue. Previous scientists whom I had contacted, they all said, throw that stuff away, it's too old, there would be no meaningful structure left in it. But I didn't throw it away. This is a long story how it came to this DNA analysis.
But there was one important finding. In a comparison of mitochondrial DNA from today's plain zebra and the quagga, there was no significant difference. Minute differences that were noticed were later attributed to post-mortem changes in the tissue sample. This gave scientific support to their efforts to start a quagga rebreeding project, which began in 1975. Selected zebras with suitable coloration were captured from as far afield as Etosha in northern Namibia and from the Natal parks in northern KwaZulu-Natal from 1987 onwards. These animals were chosen for their overall brownish tint or lack of stripes on the rear quarters. the selected few were taken to established breeding camps in the Cape. Here, through selective breeding, they would hopefully begin to produce offspring with color patterns similar to those of the so-called extinct quagga that was found in the Cape till late in the 19th century. Before gaining access to the Karoo Park, the quagga breeding project made use of various pieces of land in the Cape, including the slopes of Table Mountain below Devil's Peak, where there are still three breeding groups. Amongst them was a young animal.
Is the youngster exhibiting any of the patterns that you're looking for?
Not really. He's not one of the foals about which we are very excited. Mm. Although his father is a very good animal, his mother is not very good. His mother came from Etosha in 93. She was selected for a brownish tint. But the foal doesn't display that yet, and the striping is rather extensive. But we're also not disappointed. We knew from the start we will have foals of all descriptions. And even if you put two very quagga-like animals together, that still doesn't mean that all their foals are similar or even better than the parents.
Who is the father of that little
one? The father of that is Paul. He had to be hand-reared. His mother at the time was our very best mare. But Paul was a few hours old when his mother got killed. The problem now is he still is very attached to people, to any people, and most of the time he wants to come right up at people and push you around and so on, which isn't exactly fun. Always a bit of danger in this.
We then headed off to the Karoo National Park, where Reinhold and park management were monitoring another five breeding groups. Breeding with some of the Quagga Project zebras in the Karoo environment may have a positive influence on achieving the quagga coloration, which in all probability was an adaptation to the Karoo environment. Reinhold had not yet seen the new births in the park.
Do you recognize all of these, Reinhold?
Not the animals which were born here, obviously. Yeah. I see them for the first time, and we haven't got stud book photographs yet either. But I do recognize some of the adults which were brought here. That animal now standing a bit separate to the right, I recognize him as being that young stallion Dale. And then also the mare, the fourth from the left, that I recognize as the mare Sockies.
Right.
She was already nice and brown when she came here. And I have heard from people who had been here that she seems to have darkened since she is here.
Right. Now that one foal doesn't have many stripes on its rump, but it's very white, isn't it?
You see, this is again one of these animals where Professor Heidenreich has said, if we could cut up some of our animals and reassemble the portions, we would have an instant quagga.
Yeah.
Because that very white foal has lovely quagga legs, with not a streak anywhere, but the body is far too light. And the striping, it is reduced more than is usual, but it's still quite extensive when compared to the preserved quagga.
On Reinhold's previous visit to the park, he had not seen any of the animals in the quagga breeding project. This time, he had more luck and found a second group at Lammekieslichte.
Is this group always just three or four? How many are there, JJ?
Four.
And you don't know any of their names?
No, I'm not sure about names.
Yeah.
Of this herd, are there of those which you released into the park?
Yeah, as far as I can see, three are of those which we brought here. And then obviously that young one, half-size one, was born here.
JJ, how often do you actually come and monitor these quaggas here?
It's part of our normal patrol.
In the Karoo Park are also a number of the heavily striped mountain zebra. Fortunately, the two species don't interbreed, and therefore the presence of mountain zebras doesn't interfere with the quagga project. In June 2000, the South African National Parks publicly announced its support for the quagga breeding project.
Would I be right in saying that having SANP now supporting the project gives it a kind of credibility that where only yourself or the quagga project alone was involved? One might have said this is just one maverick taxidermist.
Absolutely, absolutely. No, absolutely. We are now having a recognized conservation body publicly stating their support for this project, and they have done that actually for years already. Now that is a very valuable point. And that makes it more difficult for those people who are a little bit opposed to the whole idea to say that. They have to be a little bit more careful now, because it's not just a little bunch of idiots, you know, it's a more serious matter now.
Chief Executive Mavuso Msamang does not believe South African national parks will attract any criticism because of its involvement.
Not seriously. No. I think everybody is waiting to see. Obviously, things like this are controversial, but we would stand by the experiment. I think we're on the way to recovering this so-called extinct animal.
You've personally met Reinhold Rau.
Yes.
What kind of person did you find him to be?
Reinhold Rau is a really great human being. I've never seen more determination. He believed in this thing, spent all his time, he came out of retirement, and pursued this thing with the zeal of I don't know what. He's just such a great believer in what he does, and he's also a great scientist.
Reinhold is not qualified as a scientist, but his methods are certainly very scientific. For every animal in the project, he has a detailed family tree, as well as photographs, to be able to correctly identify each one.
I think it is him, but unfortunately he and Stephen got a fork here, but his fork starts fairly low down, you see?
Yeah.
And Stephen, his fork starts much higher up, and he's got nothing exciting on the neck.
In order to correctly identify an animal, a clear view of all sides of any new zebra must be photographed. Fortunately, Eric did not take long to present a perfect left profile for Reinhold to get his shot. On the same day that Eric's details were being recorded as a new family stallion in the project, a carcass was found in the park. It didn't take Reinhold long to identify it as Alan, one of the original zebras included in the project.
Is his mortality a loss to the project?
No, not really, seeing that we have got 17 foals of his. Strictly speaking, perhaps he should have been prevented already some time ago of still producing foals, because he is of the starter population, the parent population, and while he was around, he might even have made a second offspring generation fillies, which isn't really the thing one wants if one wants to progress from generation to generation.
How many more generations do you think before your project can be termed completely successful?
That might take another 5, 6, even more generations.
And when are you going to be happy to call one of them a quagga?
We will be happy to call them quaggas when we are, say, halfway between the least striped ones and the heaviest striped ones of all those stuffed animals in the world's museums, which are generally accepted as quaggas.
Reinhold Rau doesn't work in isolation. He has the support of a number of conservation experts, amongst them Professor Harley here at the UCT Medical School, whose area of expertise is conservation genetics.
Professor Harley is less conservative than Reinhold in his timing as to when the name quagga can be used.
We could almost say we're there at the moment, because some of the quagga skins, if you look at them, are really a little better in terms of quagga-like characteristics than some of the animals that you'll see in our breeding program. But what we obviously would like to get to is the real classic quagga pattern of that deep brown coloration over the back and no stripes right up until about the shoulder region.
Would this project have had any legs without Reinhold's passion?
I think that's a good question, and I think the short answer is the legs would be rather weak and short. Reinhold, as you know, is an enormous character, and any project like this needs someone with the passion and the foresight and the ability to doggedly stick it through to the end. We dry old scientists, I don't think, are quite good enough in that context. You need a person with fire in his belly, and I think, if you like, Reinhold is just that sort of character. Without him, I think it would be very difficult to have got to where it has.
And of course, he initiated it, didn't he, finding that original tissue?
Absolutely. He initiated many interesting and strange things when you look into it. Very deep, very interesting, and really quite amazing man.
An amazing man, indeed. And over time, his efforts may well likely produce animals that will match the very variable original quaggas. But because to date only portions of the quagga genes are known, it will probably never be possible to demonstrate that rebred quaggas are, in all genetic detail, identical to those that were shot out by farmers and sportsmen in the 1800s.